Hello, thank you for having me here to speak. Right, I always get embarrassed by introductions, so first of all, I have to get over that and just pretend. I have lots of demos, and I seem to just always add more and more demos to my talk until the point that I'm so stressed, and I know everything's going to fail. I think it distracts me from actually having to think about what I'm going to say. So I have lots of things to plug in, so when things go wrong, it's cool. Hopefully I have enough things to cover for that. Right, I'm just going to plug the first thing in. Ooh. Right. Sorry, that's actually just me. Okay, this one's a little temperamental, and I just thought I'd show it first while it's still going. This is something that... Oh my gosh, this could be quite loud. This is something we did for a DJ called DJ Qbert, and he wanted us to add to basically turn his album cover into working turntables.
I'm coming through with jujitsu. I'm coming through with I'm coming through with jujitsu.
As you can probably tell, I'm not actually a DJ, I just pretend. So I would say these are the world's thinnest DJ decks, and they're as thin as a piece of paper. So I tell my kids that I get to travel the world and DJ to thousands of people, and that on paper, I'm the best DJ in the world. Right, I'm just going to try and show you something else. This was supposed to go at the same time, but my hat is also a DJ controller, and it controls the sound effects. I don't know if you're ever listening to some music, and you're like, you hear it building up and building up, and then you hear the drop about to happen, and then you just want to drop an air horn while you're on the dance floor. Well, that's what this hat is for. But maybe I'm the only person that feels like that. I don't know. right, where am I going? I'll show you some other things. So, do you know what? I'll just tell you a bit more about what we do. So, I am just really fascinated with just everyday objects. Just all of the things that we have around us that kind of go in between all of the digital devices that we might have. And I just love those things. And I really am fascinated by print and just how pervasive print is. And it's the most pervasive user interface. It's absolutely everywhere. We all wear things that have print on. We walk on things that have print. We touch things. We read things. We see it on all of the surfaces. And the great thing about things that are printed is they can be any shape and size. They can go in all of the physical space around us. And print's made with a manufacturing process that's in every single city. So it can be created. It can be created everywhere. And so I just kind of really became fascinated with how can I sort of add some interactivity to that print. So as so many things that are around us have kind of just been engulfed by this moving forward of what I'm calling the digital front line, which just vaporizes everything in its path and basically sends it up to the cloud. How can we take some of those things and take the essence of digital, which I'm kind of calling a digital soul, and put it back into those physical things and somehow make them connected and interactive, but really in a way that they're just magical and not technical. And I'm really obsessed with how I might do that. So the way we've been doing it is we've kind of created our own way of making things, which involves printing conductive ink, which I'll try and show you on this. So we print conductive ink onto a sticker, and then I was going to pass this around, but it's a little sticky. And we have this piece of electronics that sticks on it. And this piece of electronics, this circuit board, it's common to every single thing that we create, but we change the piece of print and we change the graphics that's on it. So now you can touch this print in different places and it has this sort of like digital heart with a digital soul that allows it to connect via Bluetooth or just allows it to play sound directly. So some of the other little posters that we've made. So I either create things that you touch and a Bluetooth or touch and then they play some sound. So I'm just gonna use this microphone. I can't play drums either. I need to learn how to play drums and play piano. Right, but I'm gonna pass these around so you can have a play. Have another one. So does someone want to come and grab these? And you can have, you can make some noise while I'm doing my talk. Yeah. So when I think about design, I think about if we want to design something, we kind of have a desire of how we might want to create that thing, but it's also massively influenced by, I love the disturbance that's been caused now. it's also influenced by the way that we make things. And so many things that we have around us are made from injection molding plastic and bashing metal and cutting pieces of glass. And that's why nearly everything looks the same as this. Even just at breakfast this morning in the hotel, to get the orange juice, you have to touch an iPad that has orange juice, apple juice, or something else. Because there's no easy way to create some kind of human interface that's, for some reason, not as cheap as it is to make an iPad. And that's because the tooling costs are so high to make anything that every single thing that we make generally has to be the same. That's why like most light switches are the same. An iPhone or an iPad only becomes affordable when we make them in the tens of millions, because the tooling costs millions. And also, that means that the places that they're made are made generally by a million people in one factory in China, and they're designed by one large group of people sat in one part of the world. And so there's no way that that can be democratized. So every product starts to look the same and is always made in the same place. So I'm fascinated by how can we democratize that? So if we can start to make things with different processes, and this is why I'm fascinated by print, and if we can develop software tools that would allow anyone to design one of these objects. So what we've been doing is writing tools that would allow anyone to print out a sticker, put it on an object, put a conductive ink sticker on, and just write an app in 1 minute without any coding skills and create some kind of interactive experience with something like this. And so then you kind of democratize the process of design and you empower anyone to do it. And you democratize the process of creating prototypes, but also putting those things into production. And I'm really fascinated by if we can start to do that, then what type of things would we be able to create now that maybe we have different ways of creating things than making a plastic children's toy that many of them have to be the same, or something like a smartphone, or using an iPad to order your orange juice. So I think about that a lot, and that's how we create some of the things that we make. I'm going to show you another one just because it kind of creates some more disturbance and it's fun. So the other thing that I love is when we mix together like artwork and sound and concept, and right. So we made this with a music studio in Brooklyn called Ant Food, and it's an intergalactic alien rap battle. I'm not sure why they created that. Maybe it's on theme. So these little touch points here trigger audio loops. And then the characters trigger the vocals. News for you, ain't got nothing on me. I breathe gasoline and I rap on the threes. Tinkle steam, I've got the tinkle steam. I've got the tinkle steam. I've got the tinkle steam. I've got the self-esteem. To drink four locals for the whole damn team. Or maybe five hours in the stand. And now we're about 6 packs. With some blow and a powder. 7-7.
7 and 7, you know I'm I'm a star, I got mad soul. It's more like a tadpole.
Dingle, dongle, ding.
Oh, I kind of forgot there was people there. Just hold on. Okay, just create more disturbance. Yeah, so the thing that I'm really fascinated by is how to bring the sort of this digital world back into these objects, and how we create these things that are somehow magical and interactive. And I'm just also been inspired a lot by thinking about why we design products the way that we do, and I'm trying to think if it's relevant to show this. I think I'm going to tell a little story, which is a little different. I love going camping. And I'm quite obsessed with going camping, and I have this little hammock, and I like to go winter camping. So I sleep in my hammock, out in the wilderness on my own, and. Maybe I'll try and show a little photo. Sorry, I tend to just distract myself with other little stories, but hopefully it's vaguely relevant. Okay, maybe I can't find it. It's fine. I was going to show a photo. I went on this little camping trip earlier on this year, and I went up a mountain in New York State. And it was winter, and it was the coldest night that I've ever been out camping. It was minus 20, and I was just in my hammock, and you kind of have to be really, really careful when it's that cold. I know it gets pretty cold here too, but when I'm out there on my own, I have to think about things a lot. And I might go on my hike for about 8 hours, and then try and find somewhere where I feel safe, where hopefully I'm not going to be mauled by a bear, and then gather wood for an hour, and then build my fire, and desperately try and light the fire in these really cold temperatures, and then sit there on the top of the mountain looking over everything, and then I make a cup of tea. And I am absolutely terrified of the creatures that are out there. And then I kind of thought to myself, this was last year when I was thinking this, why did I not just sit at home and flick the button on the kettle and make a cup of tea? Why did I have to go on that crazy journey? And so it made me question a lot, like, why we do the things we do. And that story just comes back to my mind because of how meaningful, memorable, and mindful that moment was. And it made me think about why we design products the way we do, and why we try to create things that make our lives easier. So then I just started thinking about, like, sort of the first thing we probably ever invented, which was how to recreate fire, and then a wheel, and then a plow. And throughout the whole sort of like journey of like sort of our human like existence, we've designed and created things to make our lives easier, to feed ourselves, to make ourselves feel safer. But we've kind of got to the point where we don't really need to do very much in our lives. Like, for most of us, our lives have become so easy through technology that we don't have to think about anything at all. So, you know, you want to just have transport, an Uber arrives. You want to have some food arrives. And we kind of don't do all of these things that take us on these journeys. And so it made me think that maybe I want to design products that actually make people's lives more difficult. In the same way that I kind of like give myself so much stress on these journeys that I go on out into the wilderness. Because I think if we can design and create things that make people's lives more difficult, then we can start to create moments that are more meaningful, more mindful, and more memorable. So I've kind of been calling that friction. Because so often in the work that we do, we're asked to, how can we remove the friction points in the user's journey through using something that we have? The thing is, if you remove all of the friction, no one will even remember that anything happened. And I kind of think that life without speed bumps just passes you by. So if we can design friction into things, and if we can make that friction somehow connect with a brand that we might have designed for, then we can create something that I might call a branded friction. And then I just started to try and think of a few things that might be. And one of the things that came to mind was like the can of San Pellegrino. So you kind of, you have the foil that you pull off the top. You don't really know why it's there. You wonder why it's there. And then you start to think, oh, maybe it's, so the the rodents don't go on the can and the can's cleaner. And so you've got this little story going in your mind as to why it's there. And then you pull it off and you fold it up and then you don't really know where to put it. and that bit of friction has slowed you down and it's made you think about the brand and about why they might care about something. And it's made that moment meaningful because of why it's there, memorable because you had to stop, and mindful because it's pulled you back into the moment. And I think there's many things like that. Like, we might want to have a cork in a bottle of wine because we think technically it's better for storing the wine. But really, I think we want the cork in the bottle of wine because it adds in that friction, and we have to remember to have a corkscrew and pull that out, rather than we just screw the top off. And I think that this friction, it does a really important thing. It stands between sort of where we are in one moment and where we might be going to in the next moment. And without that friction, we end up jumping from moment to moment. And I don't think that's generally good for our mind or our mental health. So friction allows us to go on a physical journey to change from one state to another. In the same way, you know, if you go and like buy some vegetables and things from the market and prepare the food and cook the food, it allows you to transition from coming home from work into actually relaxing and eating some food. So I mean, that's kind of something that's factoring a lot into the things that I think about, how to make journeys more difficult, you know, a little more complex to people to help them think, and how to create objects that don't all look like the same thing. I'm going to show you some more demos because I kind of, it's fun to play some music. Right. I thought I'd grab this one because it's a little on theme. I was visiting NASA, and so we made this little just poster for fun, just to kind of show something. And
3, 2, 1.
So you can touch this poster and it plays different sound effects.
Liftoff. Americans return to space as Discovery.
Liftoff of Mission 41B, the first flight of the orbiter Discovery, and the shuttle has cleared the tower.
I love I can hear the air horn. I would pass this around. This one's a little battered, but kind of just imagine, like, you know, you have a poster in your bedroom, and then you can touch it, and touching it starts to change the environment in your room and play some sounds, and kind of takes you there on some kind of playscape. I think, like, for me, going back when I was a kid, I was really fascinated with kind of hiding away technology, and I was a little weird. So I used to hide wires and switches. I used to hide wires under my carpet and up the walls, and little switches and speakers and microphones. And I'd crawl up into the loft, and I'd shout my brother and sister, and I'd get my little microphone and flick the switches and make my voice come out of different places in the bedroom. I was really weird. It was it was just to confuse them, and it wasn't really about the technology. It was just about creating this experience that just kind of made my world seem a little more magical. And then I remember another time, this is a bit sad, really, because I got one of my dad's favorite books, and I carved the inside out of the book. I think it was Captain Hornblower, which is not a nice thing to do. And I bought this radio transmitter that you could assemble yourself from the back of a magazine, and I hid the radio transmitter in the book, and I placed the book down next to my parents, and then I crept back to my bedroom, and I tuned in the radio, and I listened to what they were saying. It was... I'm kind of still scarred. What I've learned is it's more difficult to unhear than it is to hear. And weirdly now, I don't hide microphones around, don't worry. But I still carve the inside out of books and try to make things interactive, which is why I make these kind of things. So that reminds me of another book thing I've created. Bear with me, I switch demos. I did a little talk earlier on this year at TED, which was a short talk on I had a little accident, so it was a story about that accident. But I also did a workshop, and so these are the books that everyone had at TED about all the speakers. And I did these workshops where people could take their books and cut the hole in the book, kind of like I did, put one of our stickers on, and then make it interactive. And I tried to do an Ed Sheeran remix. Me and my friends at the table doing shots, drinking fast, and then we talk slow. Come over and start up a conversation with just me, and trust me, I'll give it a chance. Now take my hand, stop, and the man on the jukebox, and then we start to dance enough. Singing like, girl, you know I want your love. Anything with music I love. Yeah, cool. I'll pass that around too. You can have a little play. I hope that's... Thank you. Uh-oh. You're now the DJ, by the way. You're controlling the music. All right, enough. We made this little box as well, which was fun. I think this was maybe a year and a half ago or so. We made this for IKEA, so... They were opening an IKEA store in Memphis. So we designed this little box using an IKEA pattern, and we created some icons. And because it was for Memphis, we created a blues remix, and we sampled the sounds of the home. So this is very awkward to hold. I'm not sure if you can you hear that? Yeah. So there's coat hangers, there's tapping of glass, and water droplets, and then we added some guitar. And this is a pop-up of Beale Street. Drum kit. Yay, cool. So it's kind of like, how could we create something that is, the object itself is everything it's supposed to be about. It's an IKEA pattern, it's the sounds from the home, it connects into what IKEA's about, it's a pop-up of Beale Street, and it's about blues. And because like, the object itself should be everything that it's trying to say in a way that it doesn't even need to say anything, because I believe it's more important that we design things that help people feel something rather than know something. And I think that feeling is so much stronger than knowing, and knowing so often relies on language. I'll pass it around too. It's a bit fragile, but could I pass it to someone? Yeah, so you can play. Right, what else have I got? Okay, I'm going to try and show another demo that I've actually never shown before. It can go horribly wrong because it's totally new. I think it's just an early prototype that we made last week. So if this does, this may well not work.
Muno, be careful!
Oh, yeah. Okay, actually worked, which is kind of cool. Oops. So we're playing around with the Amazon Echo. So I need to be careful I don't say the A word, because so I have the Amazon Echo down there. And obviously that's all about voice. And so what I'm really fascinated by. And as I think back to being a child and trying to make everything connected, what if we could use the Amazon Echo Smart Home Hub as a way to connect things, not just through voice, but through all of the objects in the home. So you could actually touch things, so you don't have to use your voice. So if you had a book, when I touch some, I just put some dots on this book, but I could touch things on the page. So you'd have the book, you touch the book, and then hopefully Alexa will say something. Oops, there's a little delay.
Muno, be careful! Are you okay?
I'm all right. I didn't see that rock right there.
I'll do another one.
Muno, be careful!
Sometimes my eye plays tricks on me.
Well, maybe you need to get your eye checked out. Tripping over things is dangerous.
So it's just, how can we, like, augment something onto a book and add that into the environment? I'd pass it around, but it is literally just a kid's book that just so happens to have Bluetooth in it. And then we made this too. So this is just a prototype as well. So we're thinking of making a children's like touch table surface thing, so the kids can put objects in it, and when they touch it,
lizard.
Alexa says what it is, and then
panther. Rain. Baths.
So we're really excited about the idea of that, because imagine any of the surfaces in the home, you could print out your own light switches and stick them on the wall, and or they could control anything in your whole environment. So you could print out an image that means something to you. You touch it, it could set certain lights, set a certain temperature, play certain sounds. I was also thinking about, we could imagine buying an album cover. You just bring the album cover home. As soon as you touch it, the home just starts to play the music. But you still have these physical objects. You still have a book. You still have like a wooden toy or a paper toy or a card toy. And we made, I'll try and show you another little video. We made, actually, I don't think I can find this video either. We made this like beautiful pop-up, a pop-up surface, which was cool. Right, so I'll move on from that. So that stuff is totally new. So we made a notebook, and this is a notebook for musicians, for music creators. So you can write in your notebook. Weirdly, my favorite bit has nothing to do with technology, and it's just laughing at my own joke. So I put these musical lines in the bottom here, and I just ask people what they're for, but they're for footnotes. I just thought that was quite funny, but maybe not. And so the idea is you have this fold-out Bluetooth piano, and I can't play piano either, so. Can anybody play piano? No. Can anyone play piano who's not shy? And you can change. You can try. There's a bit of a delay just with the sound system, so that might make it difficult. Ah, oh, sorry. Yeah. It stopped. I think it stopped working. Yeah, sorry. I've embarrassed you now. Sorry. Yeah, we tried. Yeah, so we made this notebook, and it's for music creators. I just wanted to create something that was kind of just magical, and you know, you could just use. So we're hoping to start selling this, and I think we've done a website called playablebook.com where people can find out about it, and we're just really excited to know what people think about that. I can pass this around, actually. Sorry, you shouldn't have asked you to give me back. Yeah. Right. It's most of my demos, I think. Yeah. So, So one of the things I just think about is the journey of like of technology and the journey of computers. And computers used to fill a room. Then they filled our desk, then they filled our lap, and then the palm of our hands. And the destiny and the journey of computers is to disappear, and to disappear into all the everyday things around us. So instead of all of the physical world we know disappearing up into the cloud, I believe that in the future we'll still have books, and we'll still have posters, and we'll still have album covers, because we're physical beings that need to live in a physical world, and our mind, half of our mind is our environment, and isn't just in our head. So we need to be connected into our physical world. And so if we, okay, I'm gonna turn the app off. and so if we can start to create all of the everyday objects so that they are the portal to a digital world, then I believe that we can make our world and our environment that's magical and not technical. And when I think of the future, I think that in the future will look way more like the past than the present. And I think that's because as much as we long for the future and we long to design things now that look futuristic, I think people in the future will be over futuristic, because we're also nostalgic. And also when we create things and we design things that look old-fashioned. So for that reason, I think the world will be not like Minority Report or the Jetsons. It'll be more like Mary Poppins and Harry Potter. And so I want to be the Mary Poppins of technology, and I want to make everything around me that's magical and that I can touch and things will happen to create this future that looks more like the past than the present. So thank you very much.
Thank you.